Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Institute of Scrap Recycling Industries Convention Chair, Kendig Neen.
Good morning. Welcome to the closing session. Closing session. 2016 history. Who'd have thought we'd make it this far? This may be our last gathering in this room, but it's far from the end of the convention. Today is packed with some of the best workshop sessions we have seen. We still have elections to do, too. That's this afternoon at 3 o'clock, or 3:30. Make sure everybody's here. And, of course, we have an extraordinary beach party this evening at 7 o'clock on Mandalay Beach. There's lots of great food, drink, and plenty to do when you get there. Today's weather is expected to be really good. It might be a little windy, but the temperatures are going to be fine. The dress code is beach casual. You will need to bring your ID for entry, but you can put them away and have a great time. Before we move on, I need to take a point of personal privilege, shall we call it. Over the last 10 years, I've had the honor and privilege to serve as your convention chair in three terms under the leadership of Frank Cozy, George Adams, and the past 2 years under Doug Kramer. Through these years, we have grown the convention, we've strengthened the program, and I believe we've helped to make improvements that have allowed this to be not only the largest scrap recycling event in the world, but one that folks in the industry just don't miss. I've been attending conventions put on by ISRI or her predecessor on and off over 50 years, believe it or not. My first paying job was delivering Scrap Age magazine for Mush Oberman to rooms at the Fountain Blue in Miami in 64 or 65. I remember how rich I felt when he paid me a full 2 bits. I was making money in the scrap industry, you know, it was wonderful. In the past 30 years, we haven't missed a single convention, only a few board meetings. But I've served on the board for 2 terms and spent 6 years as convention chair. In both cases, I was the first associate member to do so and was honored to do it. But my proudest moment came last month when I joined ISRI as a full member, and I really look forward to being one and on the other side of the stage for a few years. I'd like to take a minute to thank the terrific staff at ISRI. It takes every single one of them to put on this show, and all the work is hard, but they get it done and they make it a success. I want to especially thank Lisa Seberg, Catherine Murphy, Jonathan Levy, and of course Chuck Carr, who are the ones pulling the ropes in the back to make sure this show runs well and as smoothly as it does. Believe me, there are many associations out there that envy the overall operations of ISRI and the success of our conventions and trade shows. I want to thank that team and the team in Mandalay Bay. Note to self, don't clap in front of the microphone. Keep doing a great job. Keep making this place look like new, and we'll keep coming back for years to come. Lastly, I'll leave you with this advice. Whether you're old or young, new to this industry, or someone who grew up in it, I encourage you to take an active role in ISRI. With about almost everything in life, you get out of it what you put into it. And my association with ISRI has allowed me to make lifelong friends and some of the best people on the planet. It has allowed Aljon to grow and prosper. It's given me memories that I'll keep the rest of my life. And the members and staff that I have had the pleasure of working with have taught me much. They're an impressive group, no doubt. Don't miss the opportunity that involvement in ISRI can do for you and your company. And to you all, happy trails. I'll see you again on the other side. Thank you very much. So on with the show. It's now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Michael Condren, our sponsor from Caterpillar.
Good morning, and welcome to the closing session for the 2016 ISRI Convention and Exposition. Caterpillar is proud to sponsor today's keynote speaker, Professor at Yale University and the MIT Sloan School of Management, and author of Boom-Bustology, Dr. Vikram Mansharamani. Caterpillar is honored to support organizations like the Institute of Scrap Recycling Industries and its members. We take great pride in being a long-standing associate member and exhibitor at the annual convention, for 28 years and counting. We plan to continue supporting this association and its initiatives for many, many years to come. I'd like to thank the outgoing chair, Doug Kramer, for his dedicated leadership over the past 2 years. Doug, you've done an excellent job. Too many things for me to specifically list, but I can tell you your legacy will continue on. I would also like to acknowledge Chair-elect Mark Luan. Mark, we look forward to working with your leadership and supporting your initiatives moving forward. This morning, I'd like to talk about investment and partnerships. We at Caterpillar are invested more than ever before in the success of your company. We've invested in technology that not only increases efficiency, but helps keep people safe. I'm sure you've noticed our staff this week wearing safety vests in our display. We did that to promote the ISRI initiative of Know Your Zone, referring to the potential blind spots associated with operating mobile equipment. We support this initiative. We hope to drive it forward with one of our own technologies, the CAT Detect system for personnel. This technology utilizes RFID tags placed in safety vests and hard hats, which alerts the operator if someone or something is too close to the machine. It's an extra layer of protection for your operation, designed to minimize risks and maintain a culture of safety production excellence. The second thing I'd like to speak to you about is partnerships. Caterpillar's been in the business for 91 years due to the relationships that we have created with our customers. We are not just a large company. We are people that know you. We are people that understand your business. And we are people that are passionate about providing solutions that you need to run your business. We also have a tremendous partnership with our 175 CAT dealers across the world. We believe the partnership that you have with your local CAT dealer is critical. Our dealer network is the backbone to our country. We produce purpose-built equipment for the demands your operations rely on daily. However, we know your equipment will need to be serviced, supported, and maintained. This is where your partnership with your local dealer is so important. Keeping your machines up and running is going to help drive more efficiency into your business. Caterpillar also partners with other manufacturing companies that will provide you with a solution that we do not offer. A great example is our newly formed partnership with Lafort. If you had the opportunity to visit our display, you saw a new product, a Lafort 660-ton DOT-certified shear baler. Your local CAT dealer is now selling, servicing, and supporting the full line Lafort has to offer, adding to that total solution partnership. Our commitment to you is quality products, service, support, parts, solutions, all under one roof. We believe that is partnership. In closing, it's often said you know who your true friends are in life's difficult times. Well, I believe you know who your true business partners are in challenging economic times. I trust Caterpillar and our dealers are meeting your every expectation as a partner in the demanding times we face today. So on behalf of our extended Caterpillar family and our global dealer network, we thank you for the continued opportunity to earn your business. Thank you.
Earlier this week, the Circle of Safety Excellent Hospitality Area and Exhibit Hall, ISRI Safety Leaders, were joined by award sponsor RecycleGuard to present this year's ISRI Transportation Safety Awards. I'm pleased to announce the winners to you this morning. Company awards are given in two categories. The Fleet Award is given to the company with the best one-year transportation safety record. Winners and runner-ups appear on the screens in these three classes: small, intermediate, and medium-sized operations. The Paysetter Award recognizes companies with the best record over three consecutive years. The small class, the winner is Berman Brothers of Jacksonville, Florida. The winner of the intermediate class is Consolidated Scrap Resources from York, Pennsylvania. And the winner of the medium class is Metal Exchange Corporation of St. Louis, Missouri. This brings us to our individual safety awards, the 2015 ISRI Driver of the Year Award. In third place, with 25 variable years of safe driving, is Sean Elliott of Schnitzer Northeast of Concord, New Hampshire. In second place, with 33 years of safe driving, is Dan Storms of LP Padnos in Holland, Michigan. And I'm very pleased to welcome to the stage now our ISRI Driver of the Year Award, Mr. Mark Withrow of Cohen Recycling in Middletown, Ohio. Congratulations, Mark, and all of our winners.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the chair-elect of the Institute of Scrap Recycling Industries, Mark Luan.
Thank you. Good morning. 6 years ago in a meeting room at the San Diego Convention Center, the ISRI Board of Directors chose to give me one of the greatest honors of my life, the opportunity to serve as ISRI's Secretary Treasurer and to take the first step on a ladder that traditionally takes one to the office of ISRI Chair 6 years later. At the time, I remember several things going through my mind. I thought about how long 8 years must be serving as an officer, guiding the association. I remember thinking how smart it was of our forefathers to create this structure that allows leaders to gain some 6 years of experience through the offices before taking the reins as chair. And now, 6 years later, my experience has made me realize that their motives might have been different. Of course they want you to start out early. If they didn't, who'd want to run for office in markets like these? In all seriousness, I do feel fortunate to have this opportunity, knowing that no matter what, the upside potential outweighs the downside, given where we've been earlier this year. I intend to make use of this opportunity to grow ISRI in a responsible fashion, one that continues the work of those before me who've built a stable base of reserves that allows ISRI to meet the service needs of members. We will continue to make sure we are spending responsibly, something that is more important today than ever. We'll also look forward to what ISRI needs to look like for our next financial cycle and beyond. No organization succeeds at its fullest by simply staying the course, by doing tomorrow what we did yesterday or today. Success comes from looking not at our feet, not at the sky, but at the horizon. We must plan our way forward with an eye towards what's coming up next. We must make sure that the services we offer our members, as well as the programming we offer at our meetings and conventions, is relevant to member needs. We must constantly seek ways to make sure our spending is responsible, that our advocacy is effective, that our appeal remains strong for potential member growth here at home and around the world. One of the most important initiatives begun by our current chair was embarking on a new effort for strategic planning here at ISRI. From the start, this effort hasn't looked like your typical strategic plan. Instead, we're seeking ways to look not just at where we want to be tomorrow, but to begin developing permanent ways that we can be scanning the horizon, looking for ways that we can be more than just responsive to member needs. We want to be able to anticipate future challenges and to be ahead of them. Without question, our industry is changing. A decade ago, Joel Denbo spoke to this group as chair and said, "This isn't your father's recycling industry anymore. Times have changed." He was correct then, and that pace of change has simply increased. Markets are changing. The demand for commodity materials is changing. The kinds of material that are coming into the scrap stream is changing. For ISRI and our industry to be at our best, we must not only look for these changes, we have to be ahead of them, ready for what comes next over that horizon. Over the next 2 years, I want to continue this important work. I want to see us work to identify and highlight innovation in our industry, to encourage all of us, and particularly our newer executives, to be more involved in shaping the future for ISRI and the industry. Creating a stronger ISRI is important, and it requires some new thinking by all of our leadership. Strengthening ISRI doesn't just mean a stronger headquarters staff, a stronger board of directors, or even stronger chapters. It means exactly what it says, building a stronger ISRI. I want to promote a new thinking within our association that makes less of a distinction between chapters, commodity divisions, members, and staff. From the beginning, our success has been due to the hard work of all of these entities. And a stronger ISRI requires us to build strength across our association. When one segment is weakened, all are weakened. All of us must be involved if we truly want to strengthen this association. I want to continue efforts to engage with our international members and develop ways that ISRI can strengthen and improve relations with recyclers across the world. Doug Kramer has rightly identified this as an area of both improvement and opportunity for our association, and we will continue this great effort. For those of you who were with us in Vancouver last year, my remarks at our closing session were all about involvement. I encouraged every ISRI member who is dissatisfied with his or her state or local governmental activity to get involved, to work for the change that you want to see. And at home, we literally did just that. At last year's convention, I may have left the impression that I was somewhat less than pleased with the direction of leadership in my hometown of Salt Lake City. City government's permitting process had become so onerous that every little thing we wanted to do was a fight. When our efforts to change the minds of city leaders failed to work, we set about to change the leaders themselves. My father, my brother, and I did our homework on the candidates and chose the one we felt would best understand working with business to move the city forward. We gave her campaign money early on. We got active in her campaign. In fact, the entire family got involved in various ways. On January 4th of this year, Mayor Jackie Biskupski replaced former Mayor Ralph Becker, who lost his bid for re-election. The race was close enough that I have no doubt that the work that was done by disaffected business made the difference. Get involved. Thank you. Get involved. Get to know your representatives. Visit them in your state capitals and visit them in their local offices. Stay in touch with your members of Congress as well. We have a positive story to tell about the good we do on a local, national, and global scale. But the story doesn't tell itself. Responsible operation, intelligent management, a view toward the future, an emphasis on innovation, and a commitment to maintain the voice of the recycling industry. Those are my plans as we go forward into the next 2 years. We will look for opportunity, and we'll do our best to make ISRI responsive to your needs and ready for the future. I want to commend my friend Doug Kramer for the terrific job he has done leading us through some of the toughest times we've known. Despite the markets, he leaves a legacy that should make him proud. He's been committed to this industry and to ISRI, committed to talking with and listening to our membership, committed to providing those who participate with the best of you seen, as you've seen in these past two conventions. And his efforts have helped secure ISRI's reputation at every level. It's been an honor to work with him. Step away from the microphone, right, Kendig? When you clap. Finally, know that your leaders understand that this is your association, not ours. We encourage your involvement. If there's some way you believe we can serve you better, please contact us by phone, by email, in person. Together, we can be sure ISRI will be even stronger tomorrow than it is today. Thank you. Throughout my speech and through this entire convention, you've heard us talk of the need to be involved. ISRI's chapter leaders and national staff have been involved in working with our state legislative leadership. I'm pleased to welcome to the stage Utah State Senator Wayne Harper, representing the National Conference of State Legislatures.
Thank you, Mark. Good morning. First, I want to thank ISRI and the incoming chair, Mark Luong, for inviting me to speak today. On behalf of the National Conference of State Legislators, we have a longstanding support and tradition and a partnership with ISRI based on our NCSL Foundation, of which ISRI is an integral member. We appreciate that. We appreciate the luncheons that are sponsored, the wonderful pieces of equipment, and the bales that are presented to each one of us on an annual basis in our luncheon to go through and have us go through and calculate how many aluminum cans are there or the other little bits of trivia that are out there in order for us as elected officials to better understand the different organizations. NCSL is the nation's most respected bipartisan organization, connecting ideas, personnel, and a strong voice on Capitol Hill. Basically, we have elected officials from 50 states, all the territories in the United States, representing over 7,300 legislators, over 30,000 legislative staff. The NCSL Annual Summit is the largest gathering of state legislators in the country, and without the support of ISRI in our hall there, I don't think we'd have as great of a summit as we do now. Now, let me underscore a little bit Mark's importance on the and comments on the importance on dealing individually with elected officials. Okay, as you know, state legislators and legislatures pass literally hundreds of bills each session. Utah just finished its session. We dealt with over 1,200 bills and passed 474 of those bills. Okay, we need the input from ISRI and all of you as we go along. While we may not, while we may not always agree, it's important to have the relationship. Now, let me ask you a question, Mark. Do you like lunch?
I like lunch.
Okay. Do you want to eat your own lunch?
It would help if I ate my lunch instead of somebody else eating it for me.
That is great. Thank you. Let me talk about a bill that was introduced in Utah several years ago. Most of you will have no idea what this is dealing with. The estheticians introduced a bill and had a representative introduce a bill that dealt with the health and safety of people who have hair removals, waxing, facials, cuticles, nails, things of that nature. Okay? Guess what? They put it and presented it to us as a very, very important thing for the health and safety of the people who are getting these treatments. And they wanted to have certain hours and certain credits and things of that nature. we were not quite sure exactly what was going on. So we held the hearing, put the bill on the side, and said, we'll come back to it next week. We came back to it, and we had the esterologist, we had the cosmetologist, we had the pedicurist and everybody else coming in saying, do you realize that if this bill passes, it will put us out of business? Had we not delayed and had we not reached out to organizations, somebody would have lost their income and their livelihood. I think that's why Mark's initiative here is so critical. Because as we deal with this issue, we need to know what you're thinking, how it affects your business, and what it really means. If not, we will make a bad decision. We'll pass something that will put somebody out of business. So Mark likes to eat his own lunch. I want to make sure that all the ISRI members are able to eat their own lunch as well. Now, you may say, okay, it's easy for Mark to go through and meet with me, correct?
Yeah, we live in a smaller state. So the question maybe many of you have is, I live in a big state. I come from California. How do I affect my state legislator?
You know, that's a critical question. It's all about what you do on a daily basis. It's relationships, it's sales, it's information. Okay. One of the things that I've learned is that I can ask Mark a question and I have confidence that he will give me accurate information. That is critical. It's all about relationships, it's all about trust. He talked about not having trust in a previous mayor of Salt Lake and he has trust in the current one. My position on this is, well, before Mark and others got involved, all I knew was I'd take my aluminum cans and that down to Redwood Recycling and drop them off there, and that's all I knew about. Fortunately, they took me over and they showed me scrap recyclings, municipal sorting facilities. They took me up to mills. They took me over to manufacturing plants. So I understand what's going on and everything that's within this industry now. And yesterday helped me even better as I walked through the exhibit hall. Let me tell you, as you deal with large state legislatures like Texas, California, Illinois, first thing that you have to do, reach out to the staff. Give them a little bit of information. Tell them that you're a resource. And when they have a question, they can reach out to you. Once you get in with the staff, the next thing you do is you reach out and say, okay, I'd like to meet the representative or senator. And I can tell you, dealing with my colleagues for the last 20 years, it is a welcome, refreshing thing for us just to sit down and talk about your industry and about your issues. So as you go forward, don't be shy. Be confident. You guys have a great product. You have a great business. It needs to be respected. It needs to be treated. As you know, we turn over quite frequently in the legislatures. The average term is 6 years in the House and 8 years in the Senate. So you have a continual re-education process as you go through. I've been there for 20 years, quite unusual. But I can tell you this, the people who reach out to me, I get confidence in and I reach back out to them. It drives my wife crazy. I've got over 4,000 contacts in my phone that I have developed over this 20-year period. And I know who I can call on a variety of issues when a bill comes up or a proposal or something like that. And we go through and we can make a difference. Now, legislators, again, want to hear from businesses in your district. We want to be educated. We may not always agree on everything. But I can tell you this. You can have an impact on your state legislator. And you can have an impact on your national legislature. Take the time. Get involved. And I want you to eat your lunch. And I want you to be just like Mark, getting involved and making a difference. Okay? I don't want to have, you know, this thing I give you, the issue of the esterologist, cosmetologist, pedicurist, things like that. We had another bill last year dealing with electricians. Somebody wanted to go through and say, okay, an apprentice electrician had to be no more than 15 minutes away from a journeyman electrician. So they would do something, wouldn't make a mistake. we came to find out that it's the same issue again. Somebody wanted to regulate another company and rein them in so that they would have a competitive government-sanctioned advantage. So as we get along and as we go along with all this type, with all these issues, continue with this partnership between ISRI and NCSL. Come if you'd like to our luncheon that you sponsor. It is absolutely a blast. The first time that we did it, there's a number of people who said, why are we doing this? Now everybody looks forward to seeing the big pieces of equipment, the guessing games, the trivia. It's wonderful. I appreciate and fully support Mark's initiative of getting involved on the city, the county, the state, and the federal level, and continue doing it. Again, don't be shy. Mark, thank you so much. I appreciate this organization. Find out who your elected senator representative is. You can look online. You can call in CSL. But do it. You will make a difference. So thank you, Mark. I appreciate your time.
Thanks very much.
It is now my pleasure to welcome back to the stage our chair, Doug Kramer. And please welcome also the president of the Bureau of International Recycling, Ranjit Bakshi.
Chair Doug Kramer, Chair-elect Mark Luan, Robin Winner, President ISRI, members of the ISRI board, and above all, ISRI delegates. May I begin by bringing to you all greetings and best wishes from Bureau of International Recycling, and I would like to say that how proud and pleased I am to be here joining your conference along with my executive director, Alexander Delacour. Organizing such excellent conferences needs putting in a lot of effort, time, and planning. I personally would like to congratulate Doug and his team for hosting such an excellent conference. Please join me in giving them a big hand for the hard work. Along with ISRI, BIR has 35 other trade associations as its members and company members from over 70 countries. Together, working with BIR, we are helping to promote the global story, the global message of recycling. BIR continues as its focal theme on promoting the message of free and fair trade of recyclables, free of all trade barriers globally. Today I'm proud to say, on behalf of all the associations, to Doug, Robin, the ISRI team, that we all are very proud of the immense contribution that ISRI is making not only in USA, but to many of our members worldwide who are adopting and following much of the work that you are doing here. So I wish to thank you for that as well. Doug, well done on that as well. I would also like to add my personal welcome to some of our BIR International Association members who are here. I know we got, I don't know if they're in the audience here, we got Sanjay Mehta from MRAI, we got Mr. Jitendra Chopra, I think, Secretary from NMAR, we got BMR members and members of URIC. This association of all this membership coming here is really a strong demonstration of how all of the associations working together can help to forge a strong bond of friendship to help BIR build an industry that will continue to grow from strength to strength and ride all over all the challenges that our industry continues to face. In the words of your chair-elect, Mark Luan, we are individually responsible for making this industry a success story, not only for us, but for generations to come. In recognition of the valuable work and contribution done by Doug, both at ISRI and on the world stage, and also I would like to say for being a great friend of BIR, and above all, a truly motivated, dynamic leader for our industry, I am proud to say that I have personally, as BIR president, enjoyed working with Doug over the last year. And I would like to thank Doug for his contributions to the industry and would therefore like to make a presentation of a certificate of merit from Bureau of International Recycling to honor Doug for his work. Before I do that, I would also like to thank ISRI for a very warm welcome that we, members of BIR, my EXCO team, have enjoyed. And I would like to end by saying that BIR looks forward to continue working on this foundation laid by Doug with Mark Luan and take recycling industry to the next successful phase, which I think we all look forward over the next 10 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ranjit, very, very much. I appreciate that. Feeling is mutual. It has been a tremendous honor and pleasure to work with BIR, to get to know Alexander, and I look forward to ISRI's continuing partnership on the international, both internationally and with BIR. Thank you very, very much. Unexpected, very much appreciated. And Mark, thank you for your kind words, and I look forward to all that you have to offer this association, and I know that we're going to be in very, very good hands. But we have two other important pieces of business before we get to our speaker today. You've heard many of us say just how fortunate we are to have a staff working for us with the insight and depth of the team at ISRI. We've come to depend on them, to rely on them really in so many different ways. But there is one person on staff who may be the most uniquely qualified, having worked in and managed scrap yards in the Washington, D.C. area before putting his legal expertise to work for all of us. And I can say, I mentioned this to the board of directors the other day, that I remember when I first got active in ISRI nationally, he was the first chair of the first committee that I ever served on. So later this year, ISRI's Vice President of Government Relations and Chief Legal Counsel, Scott Horn, will retire after 21 years on our staff. Scott has helped shepherd us through the fight for a Superfund Recycling Equity Act. He's helped protect ISRI and its members from violations of antitrust by valiantly guarding our proceedings through ISRI policy and with Mama's rules. Scott was literally on the frontier of ISRI's successful work in China to manage SIQ import requirements. He's probably spent more time in China on behalf of ISRI than the rest of the staff and leadership combined. Whether it was an international crisis or a local flow control issue, Scott has always been ready and willing to assist ISRI members with his knowledge and advice. Scott's duties are being split among several staff members, so I'm confident he's leaving us in good hands. But that does not make the leaving us part of this any easier. Scott, it is with deep respect that I thank you for all you have done for us individually and collectively over the years. We wish you many years of happiness and good health in retirement. And now, to another of my favorite activities as your chair, the presentation of ISRI's Design for Recycling Award, which is given annually for innovative contribution to products designed with recycling in mind. It recognizes proactive steps made by manufacturers that have actively incorporated DFR principles into products and processes. This year, under my direction and with active involvement of the DFR Task Force, ISRI redesigned the DFR award to better symbolize the innovation that it represents. Together, working with Jerome Raft, a good friend of mine and sculptor for Pixar Animation Studios, I believe we've accomplished just that. Yeah. The newly designed award is a unique, meaningful, and captivating piece of art that conveys the movement and compelling nature of recycling while showcasing the strength, innovation, and diversity within our industry. All six of our primary recycled commodities, ferrous and non-ferrous metals, paper, plastic, electronics, tire, and rubber, are represented within the design. The DFR Award Committee once again had some tough choices to make in reviewing the nominations for this 2016 award. But before we go on with that, I want to recognize we have the sculptor with us today, Jerome. You don't mind just standing up? Thank you. It's good to have friends. Over the past few months, under the leadership of Manny Bodner, the DFR committee has spent countless hours reviewing nominations and interviewing individuals from nominated companies, all in an effort to select this year's winner. I want to thank all of those who were involved in the nomination and selection process. Please take a look at the screens.
The ISRI Design for Recycling Award is given to a company whose product design has enabled one or more of the following results at the end of its product life. Contain the maximum amount of materials that are recyclable. Be easily recycled through current or newly designed recycling processes and procedures. Be free of hazardous materials that are not recyclable or impede the recycling process. Minimizes the time and cost involved to recycle the product. Reduces the use of raw materials by including recycled materials and/or components. Against these criteria, ISRI is proud to announce this year's winner of the Design for Recycling Award.
The 2016 Design for Recycling Award goes to Samsung Electronics, specifically Samsung's 2016 curved full HD TV. This product was truly designed with recycling in mind and has incorporated easy to disassemble, snap together parts that eliminate the need for screws and are made with minimal chemical content. Additional recycling friendly traits include the elimination of toxic adhesives, paints, and coatings, and the use of polyketone, an eco-friendly material made from carbon monoxide. This is the first time that a television has been designed and built considering greenhouse gas emissions as a building block. By doing this, Samsung is diverting a potentially harmful gas and repurposing it into a durable plastic. ISRI is proud to present the 2016 Design for Recycling Award to Samsung Electronics for their commitment to sustainability in the design and manufacture of its products. Please welcome Mark Newton, Director of Environmental and Regulatory Affairs, and Dinah Ree, Manager of Recycling Programs for Samsung Electronics.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me here to accept this award on behalf of Samsung. This is an extraordinary honor for us. Samsung Electronics believes success goes hand in hand with being a good corporate citizen. Part of being a good corporate citizen is protecting the environment. Our company holds strong to its values of innovation and sustainability. We're committed to creating products that reduce our impact on natural resources and help consumers do the same during the life of the product and after when it's time to recycle. The 2016 curved full HD TV, which was selected for this award, has snapped together parts that eliminate the use of dozens of screws and make it easy for recyclers to disassemble. We've also eliminated the use of adhesives, paints, and coatings that would interfere with the recycling process and incorporated polyketone, an eco-innovative polymer made from carbon monoxide, a greenhouse gas captured in the formulary process. This TV is not a green niche offering. This model represents our mainstream product series' latest design, which we've been able to scale across the global supply chain. Our HD TVs are designed and built to be resource efficient, easy to disassemble and upgradable, and use materials that can be more easily reclaimed. These steps forward have shown how all TVs can be made more responsibly in the future. Samsung is aligned with ISRI's principles that consumer products should be economically recyclable without creating risks to human health or the environment. The recognition of this award reinforces what we do and encourages us to continue our efforts. It will drive our internal design initiatives and motivate our R&D teams to continue to innovate and lead the way to even more sustainability across all product categories. In closing, we humbly thank ISRI and the selection committee for honoring Samsung with this year's Design for Recycling Award. Samsung looks forward to a mutually beneficial relationship with ISRI and its members, and we value your insightful feedback to help us improve our designs and delight our customers. Thank you.
Congratulations, and thank you for your forward thinking about recycled materials. And now to our final presentation for this general session. When we gathered to plan this convention last July, and again this December, I made it clear to our planning team that this convention should focus entirely on helping our attendees navigate through the economic storm that has tossed us around for more than a year. Every event from workshop to exhibits to these general sessions needed to help increase sales, improve efficiency, or streamline operations. Like never before, this ISRI convention needed to help provide solutions. For most of us, nothing would be more valuable than to know where, when, and how our economic turnaround will occur, or has it already occurred? What will lead the turnaround in global demand for scrap and raw materials? Which countries are going to lead that turnaround? What can we do now to be prepared? We heard perspectives from industry practitioners on Tuesday. This morning, we will hear from a researcher, an academic expert in global economics. Please welcome Dr. Vikram Mansharamani. Dr. Mansharamani.
That's great. Thank you.
All right. Thank you all for being here. It's always fun to give a talk early in the morning in Vegas. That's never a good thing to do. Note to self, don't accept speaking engagements first thing in the morning in Vegas. But anyway, I see there's lots of you here, so thank you for coming. I'm going to encourage participation here. And in order to do that, I brought a present, a copy of my book, which will be given out to the person who asks the best question. Person with the second best question will get two copies of the book. Okay, so that's how it's going to work. Actually, in one of Doug's last official acts as chair, he will decide who deserves the book. So the question will be determined. I don't want to be the one responsible for making that determination, so Doug will stand up and at the end of the session will say that was the best question. So thank you, Doug, for agreeing to do that. All right, so let's begin. I'm going to talk to you about something that I call the forthcoming global consumption boom. And so I'll get into that. But before I get into that, let me tell you that I think ISRI's trying to support some social media endeavors these days as part of this 21st century engagement with the world. And so these are the three, I guess the first thing's a hashtag, ISRI2016. The middle one is my Twitter handle, at Mansharamani. And then the last one is ISRI's Twitter handle, at ISRI. Be careful. If you use all three, there aren't many characters left to say anything. So you got to use them with caution in that way. So anyway, well, let's begin. Let me begin by describing the world I see. And it would be, I would be failing you and probably not being fair to myself if I didn't begin with the question that's on everyone's mind, especially in this industry, and that's China. China underwent what I believe was the world's largest credit-fueled investment bubble the world has ever seen. And that popped. Let's just admit it. It's over. They overbuilt. They used debt to do so. And we're feeling the impact of that on the world today. Those ripples are falling through various markets, whether they're for commodities or countries or other regions. And so I'll talk more about that, but let's just acknowledge that's a big issue. Now, why is that a big issue? At one point, in fact, these are current data points, this is China's consumption of various commodities as a percentage of global consumption. I'd encourage you to look at the concrete number. During the years 2000 to 2010, China consumed more concrete than North America did between 1900 and 2000. That was the scale of this investment boom. And as I said, it's slowing. The growth rates will not ever return to those growth rates for those types of building in China. Now, I'll have some optimism later, maybe, but let's first stick with reality of what we're facing today. Now, this is causing this slowdown in China a real problem, a significant problem. It is actually causing the risk, I believe, of the Chinese Communist Party potentially losing control. Now, the reason that exists in this way, and I'm going to describe it very quickly, given the limited time I have with you today, although I'd be happy to take more questions on this later, is very simple. There was a social contract. You, Chinese Communist Party, can stay in power. I, the people of China, am allowed to make a lot of money. And that's been a good gig for a long time. It's not as good a gig today than it once was. And so suddenly the people are looking at the Chinese Communist leaders and saying, hold on a second, you're getting very wealthy, and I don't have the opportunities. What do? The Chinese Communist Party, in its quest to sort of self-preserve, starts an anti-corruption campaign. And that's underway. And they're trying to regain legitimacy. That is a risk that someone needs to pay attention to, is whether they succeed in maintaining legitimacy. Let me share with you another data point of potential social unrest in China. This is tracked by a group called the China Labor Bulletin out of Hong Kong. This is the number of, strikes is perhaps too strong a word, but events of social unrest at factories or by workers. And you can see the trajectory. As the economy has slowed, we're seeing almost 3,000 events of strikes, mini strikes, social unrest at working environments. This doesn't bode well for the long-term stability of China. And so they have a growth problem that they're going to try to address. The impact, of course, as I started describing, has been felt in commodity markets. And let's just run through a couple. One, Australia. Australia has had a 25-year boom. Their economy has not shrunk. They haven't had a recession. My bet is we're going to have one very soon, perhaps this year. For various reasons, housing markets are already tipping downward. The immigration that used to be the logic of why Australia would do well, that only worked when there were good paying jobs. That's why people were coming. And fewer people are coming now. And housing prices are starting to correct. And so that doesn't bode well for the outlook in Australia. Brazil, I don't need to tell anyone in this room. You can open up the newspaper any day of the week and you learn about the corruption scandal and the risk. The economy is shrinking rapidly at this point. And The currency there is down something like 50% against the US dollar. That's not a sign of economic strength. It's not a sign of stability. How about South Africa? I know there was a South African delegation here that actually returned more rapidly than they anticipated to South Africa for one reason. Earlier this week, they installed emergency measures to, I think they were sort of protecting the steel industry, sort of putting tariffs on imports and other dynamics. Why? This is a country that I believe is on the verge of being a failed state. Why do I think that? If you look at the under and unemployment rates for the young in this country, 70% unemployment for blacks under the age of 25. The underemployment numbers are slightly higher. And by the way, those levels drop, but not significantly, as you get older. If you're 45 to 55 years of age, I think the unemployment rate at that level is 25%. This is a system that is falling apart in South Africa. The ANC, which was Nelson Mandela's party of hope, 1994, is now retrenching. There's impeachment proceedings potentially underway for Zuma. So anyway, this is a problem. You got to watch this. And why does it matter? 80% of platinum is produced out of South Africa, as just to take one commodity. Canada, bastion of stability, you would think. Yeah, not really. I actually think Canada is the largest, or the world's most vulnerable developed nation, if you will. A housing boom that never actually bust. Household debt to GDP. Think of it as just the magnitude of debt, mortgages, student debt, credit card debt, etc. That level is about 170% household debt to GDP, or sorry, to disposable income, household debt to disposable income. To give you a sense of scale, that is the same level that Greece has their household debt to disposable income. So Canada is the equivalent of Greece when it comes to household leverage. Doesn't seem to matter right now in Canada because Canada has low interest rates. Now, what happens when rates change? Okay, and then, of course, all the job creation in Canada over the last 6 years has come out of, virtually all, has come out of the province of Alberta, which have been basically energy-related jobs and commodity jobs, many of which are now, you know, not growing, or sort of shrinking even. So I'm worried about Canada. The Middle East, not exactly a sense of stability. We see what's happening in Syria, but I would encourage you to look to what's happening in Saudi Arabia. Just last week, the Crown Prince, in a long interview with the editor-in-chief of Bloomberg, revealed that he's going to try desperately to sell off assets in the Saudi Arabian kingdom with the intent of diversifying the kingdom away. I think it's a little late. I think that they're actually feeling at this point the pinch. They also have a massive unemployment risk, a social stability risk, because of unemployment. 25% is the unemployment rate in the kingdom. And by the way, there aren't many great jobs that are available if you're not in a commodity-related industry there, and those jobs are shrinking. Doesn't bode well for stability in the Middle East. And of course, that instability in the Middle East is sending a million migrants in 2015 into Europe. And that's creating a whole newfound level of pressures in Europe, including the risk of terrorism. Right? And so that combination of migrants showing up with the events like Brussels are actually, I believe, nails being hammered into the coffin of the European experiment. So I believe that somewhere in the next 10 years, we will see the end of Europe as we think of it today. We will go back to having individual countries with individual currencies. Why is that? Because at this point, there's an insularity that's emerging within countries. They're saying, uh-oh, I need to regain control of my borders. By the way, what is that going to do to trade? Is that going to change things from just-in-time inventory management to just-in-case inventory management? It's a possibility. We need to watch that, particularly if borders are erected and sort of friction is reintroduced. That may not necessarily be a bad thing for all industries. Maybe an inventory build opportunity. But, and this is why I think the trade bottlenecks with the borders erecting is a possibility of that change. And of course, in this world, we've had the US Federal Reserve, at least until recently, saying that they were going to raise interest rates, which I have never believed. I don't think you can in this world that I see. And I think they're starting to come around to this perspective. Janet Yellen now, if you've done it, I've seen some analysis that looks at the words that she's been mentioning over the last couple of press conferences and how often she mentions them. And it turns out China, dollar, and global are three words that she's been mentioning more than ever before in the last two times she's spoken. That tells you a ton. They are unlikely to raise interest rates meaningfully this year, and I actually think there's a possibility, a non-zero risk, of rates going down, not up, because we've got a deflationary environment that the world is facing. This commodity, or the investment-led, credit-fueled investment bubble in China that burst is sending deflationary waves around the world and creating instability. And so, much as I'd like to see rationality of interest rates and pricing of money being appropriate, I'm not sure it's happening anytime soon. And of course, you have productivity. Technology is increasing the number of, or the output, if you will, per given worker. In an environment that we have today, too much supply, inadequate demand, the last thing we need is technology to enhance productivity. Why is that? Because technology effectively lets you do more with less. Well, hold on a sec, produce more? We have a too much capacity problem. Now you're gonna produce more? That's not a good thing to solve this problem. And by the way, you're gonna do it with less? That's less labor, that's less income for the people, that's less demand. So less demand, more supply, that's what productivity produces. Why do we want productivity? But every economist under the sun will tell you productivity. I can't connect those dots. And of course, that will result in more automated manufacturing, and that has particular implications even for countries like India that are trying to pin their development strategy on creating 100 million jobs through manufacturing in this Make in India program. I don't believe it. I don't think they're going to be able to do it. Yes, they'll get manufacturing. Yes, they'll get investment. Yes, they'll produce goods. No, they're not getting 100 million jobs because of this technology impact. What does that do to the Indian middle class? Will it actually get there? Will it grow? Will India really emerge to the power we think it can be? We'll answer some of these questions. And of course, something that's very relevant to many of you in this room, we have effectively currency wars underway. Countries using currencies to create competitiveness against their competitors. Literally competing on the basis of currencies. Now, of course, there are some times where multinational groups get together and say, whoa, hold on, this is not going to have a good outcome. We need to sort of modulate this whole thing. And I know that people have talked, at least other speakers here, have talked about China and the Chinese currency. I'll just remind everyone in this room of one data point from history. If you had gone to sleep on December 31st, 1993, you went to sleep with the renminbi roughly at 5 and change to the dollar. When you woke up on January 1st, 1994, that was roughly 8 and change renminbi to the dollar. They did a 50% devaluation overnight. Why was that? Because they faced domestic slowdown and an unrest risk. Now, if you see the world the way I do of what may happen in China, I'm not sure this idea that currency wars can be completely taken off the table. I'm not ready to do that. All right, good. We're out of the negativity. Now that I may have depressed all of you, I apologize. Now let me tell you what I really think. Everything I just said, those are the headlines from the newspaper. You didn't need me to tell you that. Fine, I might have said it in a more extreme way. I might have described it in a way that was perhaps more dramatic and more negative and possibly pessimistic in the long run. But I think it's actually all noise. I actually think this is all noise. So despite the seriousness with which I delivered those comments, I want you to forget them. They don't matter. You need to change your time horizon. And when you do, change it from this minute-to-minute, week-to-week, quarter-to-quarter logic that, frankly, Wall Street encourages and the media encourages. You need to move that off of your mindset. Just clear your head of that thinking and start looking further. And if you change your time horizons, you're going to see the world slightly differently. And so here's what I want to do. I'm going to show you a couple of maps. I'm going to describe to you what they are. And I sense that you're going to see the world differently after I do so. Here's the first map. All of you recognize this map. This is a map of the world. It's a traditional perspective we all have. A couple of countries, Asia, sort of in this size and sort of layout. Now, this is a map of the world as seen through the eyes of an economist. So what is this map? It looks funky. This is a map where the country's size, the land area on this map, is proportionate to that country's percentage of global GDP. And so what you see is the United States is obese. We all know that, but actually in the map as well. Right? Larger than it should be. Europe looks really bloated. China's large. We know China's important. And Japan looks a little larger than it should be. It's a pretty interesting map. This is how an economist sees the world. But economists are only one type of lens set that you can put. Economics is only one lens set you can use to see the world. What if we change the lens? I'm going to suggest another one, demographics. This is how a demographer sees the world. Whoa, this is a really different view. Hold on a second, what do we have going on here? India and China, of course, we all intuitively know they have large populations, so they are large, larger than we would think. The U.S. gets cut down to size. Europe sort of normalizes. And I'm gonna actually do one thing here. I want you to pay attention to Africa. Stare at Africa, and I'm going to have the slide move back. Now we'll go forward, and then we'll go back again. Look at Africa. Non-existent in the eyes of an economist. They have a hard time, literally a hard time, seeing the relevance of Africa. And yet Africa is going to become one of the most important things, most important regions of the world to think about in the longer run. So now we all hear about this population boom that's underway, right? Oh, we're going to have 9 billion plus, 9.5 billion people on the planet by the year 2050. UN Population Division says so. Where are these people coming? As far as I can tell, the United States, no population boom here. It's driven by immigration, if anything. Europe, they're not having babies. There's no population boom going on there. Keep going. China, Russia, Putin, he's shrinking the population every day. Intentionally or unintentionally, he's sending them, right? And then you go to China. They had a one-child policy. That's rippling through their economy now. The Chinese population will plateau and possibly start shrinking in the next 50 years. Okay, so Japan? Japan is old. Like, it's very simple. If you're an entrepreneur and you were going to go into a business and you want to do something interesting in Japan, I would tell you sell adult diapers, not baby diapers. That's going to be a better growth market there. Japan's got a demographic problem. They're too old. And so where's this population boom? By the way, I have some students that are real wise asses. Pardon my directness of admitting it that way. But one of my students raised his hand in class. This was a couple years ago. He says, Vikram, I have the solution to Japan's problems. I was like, oh, please do tell. There's trillions of dollars of global capital. I've been trying to figure this out. But if you got it, tell us, please. He says, what we need to do is we need to bring all the boys and girls in the room, lower the lights, and provide some alcoholic beverages. And good things will happen 17 years later. The point is they have a demographic problem. So where's this population boom? Well, we can look. And when you look forward, this is a map of the world 2050 using the UN Population Division's estimates of where the people are going to be. And what you see is virtually all of that population boom is going to take place in India and Africa. Virtually all. Not entirely, but virtually all. Now, I would also tell you, if I did another overlay here of where the world's fastest growing economies are, they're in those two circles. Africa and India happen to be where the world's fastest growing economies are today in the world. So there's an alignment. And that is creating a middle class that is about to explode in size and importance. And that's going to bring with it a whole bunch of implications. I'm going to focus on one and then mention a few, and then we'll talk about them. But this is a stunning chart, because in 1980, 3 out of 4 consumers of goods in the world, the middle class, 3 out of 4 were based here in the developed world. And by the year 2025, we're going to have had a complete flip-flop. Three out of four consumers of goods in the world will be based in the emerging markets. And that is going to change the geography of manufacturing. It's going to change the geography of consumption. It's going to change a lot. And so we're going to need to stop and think about that. But let me talk about one thing in great depth that happens when people get more money in their pocket. First thing that happens, more money, well, not one of the first things. More money in your pocket, people consume more meat. Now you might say, Vikram, why are you talking to us about this? You know, we don't recycle meat. Well, or maybe do. This is the chart, I think, that says a lot. Right now, the emerging markets, if you add up most of the countries there, as I have, and you come up with a population-weighted GDP per capita, I've done this math. I didn't want to bore you with all the regressions and stuff. But basically, the population-weighted GDP per capita for half of the world's population plus is right around $4,500. That's a number you should remember. $4,500 is roughly where half of the population of the world is on a GDP per capita basis. Well, if you can look at this chart, what you see is animal protein consumption per capita is basically a flat line until it hits a tipping point. And then you get a change of trajectory. And that change of trajectory takes place somewhere around $5,000. We're within a handful of years of being at that tipping point. So what's going to happen? Well, first of all, this is a trend that's been intact for a long time. I'm going to focus on meat, but then I'm going to broaden it. I just want to show you how this thinking process can work. So protein consumption has been up 450% in the last 50 years. This is a trend that hasn't had 3.8 billion people going through the tipping point. So this is a chart that I believe will steepen. By the way, China recently went through this tipping point. Does it surprise anyone in this room, based on the facts I've just shared with you, that China came and purchased Smithfield Foods, the world's largest pork processor? Shouldn't surprise you. And by the way, that's the beginning of a trend, not the end. And then their recent attempts to acquire Syngenta for agricultural productivity. This is a trend that's going to continue, and sadly, it probably means higher food prices. And higher food prices usually result in unrest. It's a pretty consistent trend through history that we get social unrest, usually driven by any spike in food prices. So we may see food riots. Now the question is where? Well, one measure of food vulnerability is how much a family spends on food as a percentage of their budget. And so let's just take two examples. I'll walk you through them, and then we'll see how this trend of emerging market middle-class consumption can affect the world. What I'm trying to show you is taking how something seemingly irrelevant to your industry can come back in because it's all interconnected and affect your world. So, Pakistan. Pakistan's GDP per capita is roughly $1,500. For the ease of math, let's just assume it's $1,200, $100 a month, just to make my math easy. So $100 a month, Pakistani man brings home in his pocket. Now he's got to pay out $45 for food right away. The rest is spoken for with shelter, healthcare, transportation to and from work, etc. Now what happens when food prices go up 20%? He's got to come up with 10% of his budget. It's got to come from somewhere. Now his daughter's had a cough for the last couple days. She really wants to go to the doctor. Is he going to take her? You betcha. There's not a parent in the world I know that wouldn't take his daughter. Leaky roof. It's got to be fixed. Shelter, it's important. He's going to fix it? Probably. Needs to live somewhere. How about the bus fare that gets him to work? No income if he can't get to work. What's going to give? My bet is he takes to the streets. My bet is this is social unrest. And this scares me to have Pakistan and other, you know, Indonesia's up there too, large countries, large population countries up there on this food vulnerability side of things. What would this do to South Asia if you had unrest? Now here down in the U.S. And sort of the developed, richer countries, we spend small percentages of our budget on food. By the way, I'm not sure where this data comes from, because my wife, she shops at a place called Whole Paycheck. And so for me, personally, my data point's off the chart, but maybe I'm an anomaly, because she sees every week, Whole Paycheck. All right, so by the way, let's go back, sorry. I pulled a fast one on everyone in this audience, and maybe some of you caught it, but I was talking about protein demand. And then suddenly, with a magical sort of thing, I started talking about food prices. And you might say, well, Vikram, there are a lot of foods that are not animal protein. And I'm going to actually take issue with that. I don't think that's true. And here's why. 1 pound of chicken that you consume, the chicken had to consume 2 pounds of grain. If you eat pork, 1 pound of pork. The pig had to consume, 4 is what I'm using here. Tyson's will take issue with this. They say it's 3.5 or something like that. But anyway, 4 pounds of grain that had to go into the pig to produce that 1 pound of pork. And if the world starts all consuming beef, we have a problem. Because it takes 8 pounds of grain to produce 1 pound of beef. Now I tell you, when you get this steepening of protein consumption, what do you think will happen to grain consumption? Because as this famous food writer in the United States writes, you are what you eat eats. So you may eat beef, but you're really eating corn. Well, I'm going to push that analogy a little further and say you are what you eat eats eats. Because the corn, the grains, they have to eat. And they need water. That's another scarcity problem that's coming. They need sunlight. They need appropriate temperature, so climate change will come into play. And they'll also need fertilizer. And fertilizers, sadly, are not evenly distributed. They're just not. I don't want to bore you with plant health and plant growth and bottlenecks to them, but basically there's nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. Those are the three ingredients that plants need to grow rapidly. And I'm not going to talk about potassium or nitrogen because they're sort of more evenly distributed, but phosphorus, mined in the form of phosphate rock. This is the data for global distribution of proven phosphate rock reserves according to the U.S. Geological Survey. Morocco is likely to be more powerful in the land of fertilizers, therefore food, than OPEC or Saudi Arabia ever was in the land of oil and energy. That is a big shift in how to think about the world of power. They literally will be King Morocco. Now, because of that, can you imagine a world where people start acquiring strategic fertilizer reserves? And does that in time start resulting in hoarding and sort of a self-fulfilling dynamic? Maybe. It's worth thinking about. So what I tried to show with that example was more money, more meat ripples through the world and can affect your world. And by the way, I'm happy to talk about this during Q&A if anyone has an interest. Every single gram of phosphorus that's ever been placed on this planet is still here. It's just been dispersed. And there may be a recovery/recycling opportunity even in that world. And I can talk to that during Q&A if anyone has an interest. All right, let's talk about a couple other things that happen when people get more money in their pocket. They move more. And that consumes usually energy. But for sure, they buy cars, and I'll come back to that. They travel more by airplane. That puts greater wear and tear on these big cylinders flying through the air. It puts more pressure on innovation, and it also further exacerbates the demand side for fuel. Because at least to date, we don't have a good alternative for jet fuel to take a plane from New York City to Hong Kong nonstop. You tried to put lithium-ion batteries on that plane, the plane couldn't get off the ground. So that's not going to happen anytime soon. People consume more medicine. This is a spectacular and a very tight relationship. More money in your pocket, more medicine consumed. And it's as solid a relationship as we can see. And it makes sense, because first it's emergency care only, then with time you get to vaccines and preventative care, eventually you get to dentistry and cosmetics, and then you sort of develop into this huge medical infrastructure. And that's happening around the world. Smartphones. Smartphones will continue to boom. In the next 5 years, it's estimated that we'll have almost 5 billion smartphones. So more money, more smartphones. And of course, that will produce more electronic waste. More money, more cars. I mentioned this earlier with movement, but in the next 35 years, we're going to produce 4 billion cars on current estimates. 4 billion cars. That is roughly double all cars that have been produced to date. Talk about an acceleration. This is an emerging market-driven story. 4 billion cars in the next 35 years, double what was produced since 1900. So we have some acceleration going on with this middle class. Now, I wish it was that simple and that easy to describe a dynamic I see coming. But sadly, there's uncertainty, and there's probabilities around this thesis. So let me share some of those with you. One, we started with this dynamic where I showed you these two maps, right? You had one map that was the map of demography and where people are, and then I had another map where economies were big. And so there's this relationship between income and demographics. Now, the UN Population Division assumes that when incomes go up, birth rates fall. And that's been an assumption that's worked for a long time. Except it's not working in Africa right now. We're seeing huge gains in income. We're not seeing birth rates drop. The average woman on the African continent will have 4.4 children over the course of her life. You need 2.1 to sustain a population. What that means is you're going to have some really surreal dynamics if trends don't change, which they likely will. We hope they will. Maybe they, but if they don't, we have some really, really interesting data that can come out of that analysis. So I'll share just one with you, and again, happy to talk more later. At current trajectories, Nigeria, which is roughly the size of Texas from a land area perspective, we'll have 1 billion people by the end of this century, by 2100. 1 billion people in a country the size of Texas. That's what happens if these trends continue. Now, they may not continue. Maybe there's reasons why. Maybe we haven't hit the right tipping point where birth rates will fall in Africa. Maybe there's some other issues. I go to the African continent at least twice a year. I serve on the board of an African investment fund. And I've asked people, what's going on? And I think there's a couple explanations. One is religious. Two might be actually sort of a cultural dynamic. It used to be that African women would have lots of children because not all of them would make it. But now it's a source of prestige, power, and social standing. I can have 10 children because I can afford them. That's a different dynamic. I don't think the UN Population Division was expecting that. The implications are that the world may have a lot more people, even than those big numbers suggest. The last possible explanation, at least that I have, for at least a dynamic in Africa, is maybe that's just lack of education. Maybe that we need more women's health education and some other dynamics to play out. And maybe that will help understand what's going on. But the point is, I talk to you about income rising rapidly in places where populations rise rapidly. But if the populations rise really rapidly, well, then per capita income doesn't rise, right? Because the denominator goes up faster than the numerator. And then we got to start calling into question the whole thesis. But look, there are all sorts of opportunities that come out of this dynamic, nonetheless, the African population boom aside. First of all, we talked about more money drives more meat. Let me introduce another variable in this chain. Western diets produce Western diseases. So, what's the entrepreneurial approach here that could be a big opportunity? Cut a joint venture with Tyson's Food and Pfizer. Have some beef, here's your Lipitor. We could market it globally. Why not? I know it sounds funny, but these are the same drivers. So anyway, it is intended to be a joke, but sadly the Western diets are producing Western diseases, and we're seeing great evidence of diabetes rates, heart disease rates, et cetera, rising in the world where the Western diet and Western lifestyle and more packaged consumed goods, et cetera, are going. All right, so those are some complications, but my thesis could be wrong. Where could the thesis be wrong of this absolute global consumption boom that will be unprecedented in scale, that will move the needle on most consumption items bigger and harder than has ever been done in the world before? Where could that thesis be wrong? So let's talk about that. First of all, I told you we were at $4,500, and there were some tipping points around $5,000. By the way, that tipping point of $5,000 is true in energy. It's true in air travel, healthcare, and some of the other ones. There's no tipping point. It's just growth. What if growth doesn't continue? We are all assuming, I think all of you assumed when I said 4,500, tipping point at 5,000, that the 4,500 would in fact get to 5,000. But what happens if we don't get the economic growth in the world? There's no reason the world has to continue to grow. It has, in our memory, with little blips. But if you had taken any of the, if you'd gone back to the medieval era or even the Egyptian times and you'd extrapolated even a small growth rate continuously, you'd have a much larger economy than we do today. So clearly growth doesn't continue forever. These are four countries that I think are illustrative of population problems, and potentially Iran being a slight positive perhaps. But China, massive growth slowdown. Thailand, regular coup cycle of every 4 years. There seems to be a coup. Ukraine, obviously the Russian relationship has maybe dampened business confidence there. Iran, possibly a growth supporter, accelerator, I don't know. But let me share with you one indicator that I use, which is tends to be a fun one, and I hope you'll find some value in this. So it turns out the world's tallest skyscrapers are spectacular indicators of bubbly conditions and where I believe economic slowdowns are forthcoming. So let's take a look at the data. Right here, upper left, 40 Wall Street, followed by the Chrysler Building, followed by the Empire State Building. All three competed to be the world's tallest tower in 1929 into 30, 31, and then we had the Great Depression. Then we had the Sears Tower and the World Trade Center, 73, 74. We had a decade of stagflation that felt like a bust to anyone who invested through. Then the title of world's tallest tower moved to Malaysia in 1997 with the Petronas Towers. And the Petronas Towers took the title basically months, or possibly a year, depending on who you want to ask, before the Asian financial crisis. In 1999, construction was started. There was a little delay, so I don't think it was finished till 01. We started construction of Taipei 101, the world's tallest tower in Asia, the world's tallest tower in Taiwan, that was basically ground zero of the tech boom, at least in the hardware sense, foundries, semiconductors, et cetera. And we had a tech bubble burst. And then July 2007, we had, before it was completed, actually, the Burj Dubai, renamed Burj Khalifa, take the title within weeks of global equity markets peaking, and it telegraphed the credit bubble. Now, why does this indicator work? It works for three quick reasons, which I think all of you will appreciate. Number one, these are usually signs that there are easy money conditions at work. Banks are confident and happy to give you money. They're loose with their checkbooks. Here, money, good. Project, here you go. So that's number one. Number two, these are all speculative by nature. They are saying, build it, hopefully the tenants will come. And lastly, we've been around long enough. Building buildings this tall to claim the tower of world's tallest is a bunch of chest thumping. It's egotistical, it's hubris, it's overconfidence, it's done for non-economic reasons, and therefore is very good at telegraphing bubble tops. Has anyone been to the top of the Burj Dubai? Yeah? Well, so the view from there is what? It's the desert followed by water. The view 30 stories lower? still the desert, followed by water. If you're going to build a building that tall, put it so you can see something. Put it near the Himalayan mountains or something. And by the way, for a story, I'm not sure, an anecdotal story, but if you mistime the elevators from the top floor and you go down, not the express tourist elevators, but the other elevators, you mistime it, you push the button, the elevator is as far away from you as possible, stops on every floor, you finally get in, it then stops on every floor as it goes down, you get to an elevator bank, you now cross over to the next elevator bank, push down, it's as far away from you as possible, stops on every floor, you get in it, it stops on every floor, you land in one of the world's largest malls, you meander through that mall and eventually reach the surface of the earth. That commute could take up to 40 minutes. So I think there's some hubris involved here in these buildings. We don't need to be doing this. But this is history. And you don't want to know history as much as you want to know what's going to happen in the future. And so I'm going to give you a website right now that all of you can look at whenever you want that will tell you where the future tallest towers will be, based on current expected building plans. And I can tell you this website, it's called skyscraperpage.com. It's a website that's used predominantly by architecture students and art historians. Very few in finance and economics even consult a website like this. And I have to tell you, it's wonderful to give you big picture indicators. Now, last year, or 2 years ago, that website had replaced the Burj Dubai. For the 2015, the world's tallest tower was going to be something called Sky City. Sky City was a project in China where they said they would build the world's tallest tower. Now, the Burj Dubai took 7 years, $5.6 billion, numerous construction delays, cost overruns above that, etc., to complete. The Chinese said that they were going to build Sky City at a price of less than $1 billion, and get this, in under 90 days. I heard that, I said, that's lovely. I'm not going in it. That's fine and dandy, but I'm not going in it until there's a good typhoon. They never built it. They had delays, etc. It never got constructed. But here's what the website tells you right now. It says that the new title for world's tallest tower, at least based on currently existing plans, is going to move to Saudi Arabia. Now, what does that tell you based upon the risks I was describing earlier? Another confirmatory data point. It's not clear growth will continue indefinitely. Secondly, I gave you that meat thesis. I told you half of the world's population was going to start consuming more. What about the Indians? Indians have there's a large percentage of that population which is vegetarian. And there are a large number of people in India. So should we throw away the whole thesis? Well, roughly 20% of India's population is not Hindu. So right there, we got 250 million people, roughly, that we think at least may consume some meat. And even within the Hindu population, there is some percentage that do consume meat, and it may be type of meat rather than amount of meat. And maybe they're more chicken biased than beef biased, etc. So, but it's a question to watch and monitor, especially based on that thesis. And, you know, there are other unique things coming out in the land of food, sticking on it, which, again, the intent here is to show you how seemingly unrelated dynamics can come back and affect your world. Well, you may think this is a weird development. These are two salmon, same exact age. The one behind has been genetically modified, splicing a coho salmon into a Chinook salmon, and letting that be the hybrid Frankenfish, whatever you want to call it, in the back. This is US FDA approved today, right now. You salmon you consume may in fact be genetically modified. This has happened. Now this could take away some of the pressure for the meat consumption and the animal protein and the food prices, which could result in a more stable world, which allows the economies to grow faster, which will come back and help you. So this is how you can sort of connect some of these dots. Now, not far from here in Nevada, we have the Ivanpah Solar Development. And this solar development has all these computer-programmed mirrors, and they all change and they point towards that central glass water tower. The mirrors reflect the sun. It heats the water, creates a steam turbine that generates electricity per tower of roughly enough to power 60,000 homes. Really successful, I think, although it went bankrupt for some period of time because of financial structures. But from a hope perspective, it's promising. That could change the energy dynamics. Now, by the way, the same student I had mentioned to you earlier raises his hand, says, Vikram, because I share my slides with my students. I always have fun with them and sort of let them hear what I think. He says, Vikram, slide is wrong. It's not an energy slide. It's a protein supply slide. I said, "I, please educate me, oh, smart student." And he says, yeah, you're obviously not reading the stuff from the environmental groups, et cetera, but it turns out that the rays of sun, when reflected, if a bird goes near the glass cooling tower, it gets killed, and so this is a fried chicken slide. I said, well, duly noted, and I promise I will tell any audience with which I use this slide your story. So I feel like my obligation is complete. All right, in energy land, one last development that is needle-moving that you can't ignore. 15 years ago, if you had gone to a large energy technology conference, there would have been some guys in the corner of the room talking about something called shale, fracking. And most of the people in the middle of the room ignored them. Yeah, fine, they've been talking about this wild stuff for a long time. It's not real, we don't believe it. Not gonna change my world. So I ask myself often, what are the guys in the conferences like this thinking about in the other corners that people are ignoring? And I think if you go to the energy conferences today, what you hear very fringy groups talking about are something called methane hydrates. Now, methane hydrates are literally frozen natural gas crystals that are on the seabed floors around the world. Now, I'm going to say these words carefully, and I'm going to tell you that what I'm saying is 100% right based on the data we have today. The proven reserves of methane hydrates in the world today could fulfill U.S. energy demand for all forms of hydrocarbons for somewhere between 100 and 3 million years. Somewhere between 100 and 3 million years. I realize it's a big band, but that's according to the U.S. Geological Survey, et cetera. So you may say, well, Vikram, how much does it cost to produce some of this gas? You need right now $30 gas to get it be economic. So no one's doing it yet, but technology's gonna bring that down. And the same way we thought fracking was crazy, someday this is not gonna be crazy. And by the way, the Japanese, out of sheer necessity because they're energy constrained, are developing this today. I bring this up again, why? Because this can affect your world. Energy prices, what if you had permanently cheap energy? It would power some of those economies like India and Africa that are so energy dependent. You may get higher growth rates for a longer time, and you could have new manufacturing industries sprout up in different places if energy prices were lower for longer. I don't have a view as to whether that's likely. I'm just saying it's a possibility we all have to think about. All right, so what? Let's try to tie this directly to you and your industry. I figured I'd put Bob the Builder up here, because Bob the Builder, I think his motto is reduce, reuse, recycle. At least that's what I'm told. All right, so we talked about China. I told you they had all this overcapacity. I told you that they are potentially risking instability domestically. I told you that the Communist Party was worried. And I told you that I thought they were going to address it. They have today a $1 trillion development plan to rebuild the Silk Road. $1 trillion is a current estimate that I've been able to calculate they will spend on building out the Silk Road. What do I mean by building out the Silk Road? They're building this program called One Belt, One Road. They're going to create ports all around this sort of region. They're going to have highways, railways, airports, et cetera, built out, including lots of bridges and lots of buildings. And they're going to build it to recreate the Silk Road. This is the unifying development strategy that China has today. And they're working on it. And they're going to involve roughly 60 nations going through Central Asia and other parts of the world that have been dismissed and ignored by large portions of the developed economies. And they're doing this now. Now, you can ask yourself, why are they doing this? And I got to tell you, they have overcapacity of construction workers, of steel, etc. And what they're doing is they're going to create demand by building out these things. Excuse me. So this is actually a huge possible upside pressure to reignite the China that we all knew 5-10 years ago. This has that possibility. I think it's a remote possibility, but it has the possibility of creating that development and that investment-oriented build-out that we thought we may never see again. Not to give you too much hope, but it's a possibility. It's worth watching. Again, $1 trillion is what they're allocating right now to building roads, ports, highways, bridges, and buildings. But I would be remiss if I told you to focus on China. Don't just focus on China. Some of the countries I highlighted there are rapidly growing countries that you have to pay attention to, because it's more than just a China story when it comes to infrastructure. Think of India. I sort of poo-pooed the Indian manufacturing story, but India is today the world's fastest growing large economy. They passed China. And they are in desperate need of building out infrastructure that will use lots of commodities. Look at the size of their consumption right now of various commodities. Only 5% of global steel goes to China. Goes to India. That can change, and that's going to change rapidly. And potentially, depending upon what happens with the government there, potentially what happens with other dynamics even in the region, you could see that number accelerate very rapidly. Here's what India's planning on spending on infrastructure. It's going to go up to almost $700 billion per year within the next 10 years. And they desperately need it. Infrastructure building in China, you have to knock down a bridge and rebuild it because you got to keep the workers busy. In India, you build a bridge because the other alternative is to go down 50 miles down the river and cross the bridge over there and come back. So it actually improves. There's high return on invested capital. This makes sense. And so India's going to be doing a lot of infrastructure spending, and it's coming. And I'm going to tell you, it's not just China and India. So don't just keep that mindset on. It's broader than just those two. This is a report I found from PwC that shows global infrastructure is going to hit $9 trillion, global infrastructure spending, by the year 2024. $9 trillion. By the way, almost every piece of infrastructure I know generates demand for things related to that infrastructure. You build a building, guess what? People want air conditioners in that building. People want refrigerators in that building. And so even though we're just looking at the infrastructure spending here, it has a multiplier effect when you start including all the things around it. And that's a really good, positive outlook. And then, of course, we have climate change. And climate change is a very serious problem facing the world. But it's a huge opportunity for those of you in this room. An enormous opportunity. The Chinese have got to wean themselves off of some of the pollution-enhancing impacts that they've had. And so I think they're going to start moving increasingly towards some more green, more designed for recycling type manufacturing, etc. And it's not just China. I mean, India's facing similar environmental issues. And so environmental issues will support, I believe, a greater need for recycled and other reusable type products. So this is a table that I pulled from a company called Divergent Manufacturing. Their CEO and founder, Kevin Zinger, is someone I've gotten to know. And he is sort of out there on a mission to convince people to use life cycle assessment for the true cradle-to-grave environmental costs of what you produce. And what he was saying to me and shared with this data with me was, the electric cars today, if you factor in the carbon footprint of their manufacturing process, you in fact have a car that is hurting the environment more rapidly than the traditional cars. And so what he's trying to do, and the two on the right are divergent manufacturing cars, he's 3D printing chassis and then carbon fiber molding and putting stuff on top of it. He's doing it to create supercars that are not, this isn't some sort of like garage project. Here's an example of a car he built. This is a car he's built, 3D printed most of it. Carbon footprint of roughly half over the course of its life compared to other cars, even other electric cars. It's only 1,400 pounds, so you can argue whether or not you want to be on the road with other SUVs at that weight, but 0 to 60 in under 2 seconds. And so my point is you're starting to see improvement in a lot of these things. But dematerialization is a real potential threat. We need to think about that. If the world uses significantly less materials generally, what does that mean for your industry? What if you build a chassis for a car that lasts for 90 years, you never have to take it apart or recycle it, it's just good, it's built, and you just change the top? Flip it out, change it out, get a new motor, get new whatever. Flip it out. So my point is you need to think about these dynamics. They can come back and affect you. So I want to get to questions quickly. But one thing that I sense is a natural default a lot of you in this room may feel in times like we're facing today, where I started and I gave you that really negative economic overview, which I believe in is true, but it's very short term, is you can be the ostrich. You can put your head in the sand and say, I can't deal. I'm not, whatever. I'm going to lift my head up and I hope it's a better world. And I'm not sure that's the right thing to do. I think it's time today to think differently. And there's two ways to think. One is threat thinking. Notice I put the rearview mirror there. You're looking backwards. Oh my God, I've got these limitations. I'm worried about making payroll. I've got vulnerabilities. I got to hunker down. I got to shrink. I got to be defensive. But that's just one way to think. The other way to think is to say, whoa, I got an awesome opportunity here. If Vikram's statements are right, and the world is going to have this consumption boom, and there's going to be a huge increase in demand for a lot of commodities, and there's going to be a big upside pressure for a lot of the materials that go into the consumed goods and services, etc. Well, this is a gift. This environment is a gift. I can use it to expand. I can start thinking of new markets that are going to become open. I can be growth-oriented, and by the way, I don't have to pay up for it. I can expand in the midst of this temporary dynamic. So that's what I wanted to leave you with. Those are my organized comments. I'm thrilled to take some questions. Before I do, I thought I would leave you contact information in case anyone wanted to get a hold of me. LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook page, etc. Or my website, just mansharamani.com. And if you would like a copy of these slides, I realize they're just pictures, but in case you would like a copy of these slides, I'm happy to provide them. For legal reasons, I am not allowed to distribute them in a blast, so you have to email. Just email my assistant, support@mansharamani.com, and she'll get you a PDF version of these slides that we can email. So thank you all for listening. I appreciate your patience for my comments. And We'll take some Q&A here. We have microphones, so please do wait for the microphones to come to you. I see like 7 hands in the middle here, a couple over there, a couple over there. So they're all over the place, but we'll start here. Yeah.
You briefly touched on water. Can you make comments on potable agriculture and industrial usages of water?
Yeah. Water is I'm going to not forget this, that Doug has his Doug, pay attention to questions, right? You get the right ones, make sure. So water. Water is a huge problem, but again, we have the same issue that we had with that I mentioned with phosphorus. Water, every drop of water this planet has ever had is still here. It's a use rate problem and a recycling rate problem, right? So there's that. Climate change is, of course, exacerbating it by taking fresh water and dumping it into the sea from some of the ice caps. And so I think what we have here is a dynamic where we're going to sort of use it up too quickly and therefore have inadequate fresh water. Now, energy is a solution to that. We can actually desalinate lots of water. It's just energy intensive. And so I ask you to think about like the methane hydrates, how that could potentially change that dynamic and what. I don't think we'll ever get to the point where we run out of water. I think we have to learn to price water properly. And right now it's mispriced, and surprise, surprise, it's misused. And so when it's underpriced, it's overused. And you can see the dynamic. Actually, this part of the world, right here where we are, is probably some of the most extreme water potential problems in the near future, right? I mean, Lake Mead is not far from hitting that upper intake. And when Lake Mead falls below that upper intake, we got sort of a large gap of water supplies to, you know, big portions of this region will suddenly have to figure out how to deal with water. So I do think there will be an increased focus on recycling water. You know, you shouldn't use fresh water to water the lawn. And so we should have different systems of rain capture and water reuse in different ways. And I think that's probably going to come. It'll definitely come if we start pricing water properly. And I think that's the big problem. So, yeah, right here.
You talked about India, and I just don't understand how they get by their whole eminent domain issues and the government that you can't build anything there. And you know, you go visit the ports. When we went on a mission years ago, you go visit the ports and you drive down a little narrow road and there's houses on either side and you come to a beautiful port. You go to the largest steel mill out there and we're in the bus and we have to stop to move a cow out of the road. And every single time they try and build anything, the people sue and it takes 10, 12 years. And so how does India get by that?
Yeah. No, look, you're 100% right that bureaucracy and sort of at some level you can call it democracy. Let's be honest, right? It's sort of allowing people to have an individual voice. It makes it slower. There's just greater friction in that system. It takes, I think someone told me, there's a great website, the Doing Business Report. It's done by the World Bank. It ranks countries by how easy it is to do business. Ranks 173 countries. India's like 150 on that list. It's one of the hardest places to do anything, precisely for what you're talking about. And there's also the problem of these green permits that are needed. Because of the way the bureaucracy works, everyone has a holdup on the process. You want a driver's license? Okay, your application's in this long pile until I get my green permit. And then maybe we'll move it and we'll go a little faster. That system has to change. Now, to be fair, Modi is saying he wants to attack that system to make it more efficient, more fluid, et cetera. It's yet to be determined. I think you raise a really good point. In China, you want to build a new airport, you say the bulldozers are coming, everyone move out of the way. Where we go? We're coming. And they build a new airport. And you move the people and they deal with it. In India, you want to expand an airport runway? Hold on, hold a town hall meeting. Okay, these people don't want to move because they have no place to go. Okay, fine, let's build them a new area over here where they can live. Okay, we built it, now let's move them. Oh, they don't want to move. They said their business is over here too. Now you got to build them a new business area, try to make a market. Then they finally come. Okay, fine, we'll go, but we want to be compensated for our loss. This is our ancestral place. Then you pay them some money, you finally get them. 10 years later, you get an airport. So you're right, that's different, but it's just part of the process of a maturing democracy to deal with some of the inefficiencies. And the bigger problem is the bureaucracy in India. There's a lot of red tape, and it slows down. It just puts guck in the gears. So anyway, I hope that's helpful at least a little bit. So I know there are lots over here. Okay.
Are we on the front end of a longevity boom? And if so, is it baked into your population and economic forecasts? And if so, what are the implications?
Yeah, look, a spectacular question. I mean, Doug, I may actually put that one down as a potential candidate for the book, just not to influence you. Longevity is a huge issue. This is the technology problem I described to you earlier about technology producing more supply and reducing demand. The same thing happens with demographics and longevity, right? Healthcare productivity makes people live longer. The population of the world booms, and you have a longer health, you know, bigger healthcare demand story, possibly a longer healthcare problem financially for certain areas that may not have financed the proper healthcare. And it's really a technology question of whether or not we could get there. You know, I write annual predictions that I put on my website and on my LinkedIn profile. And one of them this past January I put was a company called Calico will turn out to be the hottest company in the world. And that company is working on extending human life to get through escape velocity where you can basically just replace parts of your body as they give. Now, that's going to create a different world. And you're going to have to start rationing humans at some level. And that creates social policies that may become offensive to lots of people. So I think a longevity boom, although thought to be an interesting dynamic, could be really harmful, actually, for this planet. And it would change the social structures of the world we live in. I mean, what happens if someone can live to 300 years? I mean, it's sort of, do you ever feel like the time that you're using is as valuable, limited? Is it the scarcity of life that allows you to bring meaning to it? So I don't know. I mean, we can get very philosophical very quickly. It reminds me of one thing, which I'll use to sort of lighten it back up a little bit. But I had a professor when I was a graduate student at MIT. Old guy, just was really just sort of bitter, always bitter. And somebody asked him, a reporter says to him, "Professor, how should we address the healthcare crisis in America?" He says, "Yeah, what do you mean a healthcare crisis?" "Well, you know, we can't afford it. It's going to take up a huge portion of the budget, Medicare, Medicaid, healthcare spending." He says, "You got to let them smoke. The more they smoke, they're going to die earlier. They're going to contribute. It's going to be fine." It's a little bit of a longevity problem in reverse, right? So it depends what we're talking about. Anyway, I saw some more hands. Over here, yes.
First of all, thank you for your comments. It's fascinating. Gives us a lot to think about. Two-part question. You've traveled around the world. You've met, obviously, many interesting people. Who stands out in your mind as the most fascinating?
Oh, that's a good question.
And secondly, what's the best question anybody ever asked you in a previous conference?
All right, so you're right. I get to meet fascinating people around the world. I'm thrilled. I feel really lucky. I have an amazing sort of opportunity to do this, to travel all over the place. I find some of the leaders in the Middle East to be pretty impressive people, actually. So I spend time in Abu Dhabi and other portions of the Middle East. I won't say specifically who, but some of the royal family members are really forward-looking, and shockingly so, to the point where you could ask them questions about things like, "Well, what is Trump going to do? How do you feel about Trump?" And they would say, "Look, you know, we think he's a practical individual. He may be saying things he doesn't believe in. We're going to monitor, manage, etc. But we've been here through many presidents." And we know how to manage volatility and perspective of policy. Very impressive, really genuinely forward-looking individuals that I don't think exist in many places. So I will tell you, some of the political leaders I've met there are interesting. One other person that I met who I would just comment on as being really interesting is I met some of the negotiators for the deal that's being struck between the FARC rebels and the Colombian government. And so, you know, the group that goes to Havana to negotiate. And so one of the head negotiators on the Colombian government side, again, just a man of just magnanimous outlook who said, "We need to end the 50-year civil war to make the world better. We need to help the Colombian people. We got lots of commodities and resources that we need to get into market. We need to improve our lives." But he had a sort of genuine authenticity that is rare to find in sort of negotiators that usually have an objective that's one-sided. So I think those are some of the interesting people I've met. I've met lots of other interesting people. But I don't think, some of the big-time political leaders, I frankly don't find them that interesting, actually, right? You can never really tell what they're saying and what they mean. Best question I've heard at another event, that's a tough one for me. I get lots of questions from lots of people over the time. Usually, honestly, it's something someone will find a background, something unique or interesting that they found by researching something about my background and try to raise a question about something totally irrelevant and say, "Hey, Vikram, connect that to this." And, whoa, okay, I'm stumped. So something like that. So hope that's helpful. Yeah.
I'm in the aged group. And I find being with so many friends of mine, like group, they are so pessimistic on the future. And I listen to, both parties. They're pessimistic. And yet, hearing your speech and your presentation, I'm getting out of it what I am, which is an optimist.
I'm an optimist.
And I mean, really, pessimists lose, optimists win. I mean, it's almost that simple.
Yep.
And you really have reinforced that to me this morning. If I don't take away another thing, it's that you and I are right.
Perfect. I think that's a spectacular way to end. The timer's done, and Kendig's got the hook on my head here to pull me off. So thank you again.
Well done.
We have to decide. Actually, hold on. We got Doug to decide. 1 second. Last official, or one of his last official acts as operating chair, he's going to give this to someone.
It's more than appropriate that ISRI is bringing you a session immediately following this one on the growth of the Indian scrap market. I sure hope you'll attend it. I want to congratulate again all of our winners today, Vikram, for a wonderful session, and I thank you for being here and look forward to seeing you tonight for a great party on the beach. Got a lot of good meetings in between, and don't forget the board meeting for elections this afternoon. Happy trails, all.